Thank you very much, Linda, for that very generous introduction. Can everyone hear me? Yes. If my voice trails off, just raise your hand and I'll raise it. Normally it carries. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to be here tonight. I've given several talks for the Vermont Humanities Council, and it's a truly magnificent organization. I love whenever I have the opportunity to speak as part of the Vermont Humanities organization. I want to give a talk on Douglas and Lincoln tonight. It's based on my book, Giants. I'll start out by giving a brief background about my interest in Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln, how the book came into being, then sketch out some of what I consider to be the significant themes, tell the story of those themes in a sense. Show some images to talk about what Douglas, Lincoln, and anyone at that time interested in interracial democracy was up against, and then I'll open it up for questions. It'll take about 15 minutes or so. Before I begin, I'm curious. I want to start with a question. How many of you in this room have read anything by Frederick Douglass? Hands high. A little less than half. That's better than most groups of over about 60, 55, say. Frederick Douglass hasn't entered the classroom, didn't enter the classroom until about 25, 30 years ago. So if you finished school more than 25 years ago, your understanding of American literature and American history was pretty much lily white. Douglass, who was one of the most important and popular writers in the 19th century, was out of print for most of the 20th century. How many of you in this room have not read anything by Abraham Lincoln? As I suspected. One of the things I hope to convey in my talk is that, in my view, Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass were among the two preeminent nonfiction writers in not only American history, but in the English language. And if every American were required to read both Douglass and Lincoln, in my view, this nation would be a better place. So that leads to one aspect of the background. I first and was fortunate of reading Frederick Douglass when I was 13 years old, growing up in the Midwest, Iowa, Nebraska, and North Dakota. A friend of mine gave me Douglass. And Douglass's narrative, it's a short 80-page narrative, a romantic 19th century narrative. Most of it is describing his efforts to escape from slavery. And in a weird way, I wanted to be Frederick Douglass, because he just captured my imagination in ways, at that time, that few other books did. And I read it more than once. In fact, reading Frederick Douglass led me to a number of other Civil War authors. I'd read some Lincoln. He led me to Lincoln, Emily Dickinson, Whitman, a number of other political figures. And that experience was one of the things that led me ultimately to want to get a PhD and write on the Civil War era. The professional background for my interest in Douglass and Lincoln is while I was working on my first book, which essentially was on interracial friendship of two black and two white abolitionists. Frederick Douglass was one of them. I realized that Douglass was the first African American to meet with and advise Abraham Lincoln three times in the White House, the first black man to advise a U.S. president. The term advise is crucial because many blacks had met with the president before. The next time that a black man would meet with and advise a U.S. president, by my calculation, was in the 1960s when Martin Luther King Jr. met with and advised Lyndon Johnson nine times. Now, many other blacks met with presidents, but those who actually advised a president and to the degree to which the president acknowledged it is that there's a huge gap. And at that time, no one had written the story, or one, there were the longest essay was a 10-page essay on Douglass's and Lincoln's relationship. And while I was working on the first book, I thought this was something that I might want to pursue, and that ultimately led to an essay in Time magazine on Douglass and Lincoln when Lincoln was on the cover in 2005, and I enjoyed the research so much that it led to this book. The central thesis or the central argument of the book is that Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln are the two preeminent self-made men in American history. They met three times in the White House, considered themselves friends at a time in which friendship connoted equality. Friendship was seen as a symbol of a virtuous Republican society. Long before they ever met, they led surprisingly parallel lives that ultimately converged in this friendship. Now let me unpack that long sentence. Douglas and Lincoln, you know, Lincoln grew up dirt poor in a log cabin. Douglas was born a slave. Neither man had virtually any formal education. What you might not know is Douglas had zero education, was prohibited from reading or writing because he was a slave, and Lincoln had less than 1 year of formal education. And more than any other factor, these two individuals who started at truly the dregs of society for white and black, a slave, and Lincoln was referred to as poor white trash. More than any other reason how they were able to rise up is because as young boys they learned quickly the importance of words as weapons, the power of language. And long before Douglas and Lincoln ever met, they virtually memorized, cut their eye teeth on the same six books or authors. Any of you want to guess what those are?
Shakespeare's one.
Shakespeare, who is considered one of the greatest, if not the greatest writers in English today, was also then. The difference is that Shakespeare today is read primarily in school. At that point, everyone read Shakespeare. If you could read, you read Shakespeare. If you had two books in your shack, in your cabin, one of them was Shakespeare. And both Lincoln and Douglas could quote Shakespeare more extensively than Stephen Greenblatt or any other Shakespeare scholar today. And if you memorized and cut your eye teeth on Shakespeare because of the sophistication of his language, it's hard not to become an effective writer, an orator. So you're on a good start. What else? Bible, the King James Bible. Among other things, one of the greatest works of world literature. What else?
Blackstone's Law.
That's a good guess. It was a little bit above their head. But Blackstone is a good guess because Blackstone's commentary, four-volume commentaries on the Law of England, became the foundation for American jurisprudence. The foundation of American jurisprudence. Other guesses? We got two. We got... Pardon? No, you're pitching it too high. Yeah. Pardon? That's a great guess, but Lincoln certainly read that. Douglas didn't until he was older. Two of them are difficult because if Shakespeare was the most popular writer in English then and today is considered the greatest, at that time Lord Byron was also considered the second greatest. And Lord Byron is not as widely read anymore, the great epic poet. Americans in particular had an absolute love affair with Lord Byron. They considered Lord Byron an American freedom fighter. Byron devotes his life to fighting for freedom in Greece. He dies in Greece fighting for freedom. And his huge runaway bestseller, Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, essentially describes in epic poetry a self-made man. And Douglas and Lincoln both quote extensively from Lord Byron. The third, yeah.
How about the Federalist Papers?
No, that was already suggested, Federalist Papers. Not until they were much older, not until they were adults. It's a little just too above them. Robert Burns was the fourth. Robert Burns, as the great Scottish poet, farmer, poor farmer, who turns his dialect into an art form. And Lincoln in particular, according to many people, virtually memorized all of Burns's poetry. And Lincoln had a profoundly pronounced accent, like Burns did. Lincoln pronounced his name Lincoln or Lincoln, according to most contemporaries. And unlike Frederick Douglass, never lost entirely his dialect. So Lincoln was especially captivated by the ability to use or to transform a dialect into an art form that Burns does so brilliantly. Any other? Yeah. Pardon? No, that's another good guess. One is Aesop's Fable. The fifth is Aesop's Fables. You're all familiar with Aesop's Fables. What you probably don't know is that when Douglas and Lincoln read them in the 19th century, there's no moral underneath a fable. It was just a story. And what you probably don't also know is that Aesop's Fable, the best way to summarize it, is that it's a collective slave narrative. It's a collective narrative in which Aesop summarizes the story of slaves in classical antiquity. So it's these stories of how to survive a vicious world that Douglas and Lincoln are both enraptured by. And the sixth, it's very hard to know, it's the Columbian Orator. It was a collection of speeches designed for young boys like Douglas and Lincoln to become effective orators, edited by one of the 19th century's great educators, Caleb Bingham. And Bingham understood that most young boys, and at this age, usually it was young boys who aspired to become orators and public speakers, most young boys did not have the luxury of formal education. And so he put together these snippets of speeches to help them become effective orators and public speakers. It was an era in which public speaking was one of the few forms of entertainment. People would travel for hundreds of miles to hear a debate, to hear a well-known public speaker. The best analogy that I would use is that it's analogous to being a professional athlete or a Hollywood movie star or a television personality or radio personality today, because there's virtually no other form of public entertainment except fighting in the backwoods. And Douglas and Lincoln, they cut their eye teeth on Columbian Orator, and they also paid close attention to Caleb Bingham's introduction, in which Bingham is describing how the importance of enunciating your words properly, measuring the cadence, the meter of delivering your speech, so that you can become an eloquent orator. And in fact, one of the things that Bingham says is he borrows from Demosthenes and says, if you have an accent, it's important to enunciate your words properly. If you have an accent, take a little pebble and put it under your tongue so you understand, you can feel the location of your tongue when you're speaking, and it'll help you lose your accent. Douglas lost almost all of his accent to such a degree when he started public speaking. A number of whites accused him of being a fraud because he was such a brilliant speaker and had such a brilliant way with words. Lincoln didn't heed Caleb Bingham's advice, you could argue, as much as he should have, because when Lincoln was a president, a number of Yale and Harvard educated men, after meeting with Lincoln in the White House, said he sounds like a yahoo, even though the substance of his message was profound. And those six books were indispensable that both of them read, by far the most important aspects of their rise up. What you probably also don't know is that in his day, Frederick Douglass was considered a far more effective orator than Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln was considered good, very good, but not truly exemplary in the way that Frederick Douglass was. And Lincoln was hamstrung in a couple of ways. One is that the three adjectives most used to describe Lincoln's look or his appearance were ugly, awkward, and grotesque. And if that's how you're perceived in your day, you're against the eight ball, so to speak, being an effective orator. You want to appear pleasant to your audiences. Lincoln also had a high-pitched voice. It could carry very far, could carry beautifully in an age before microphones. But it wasn't musical, and he recognized that. So he made the most of his truly grotesque physique. He's 6'4" in his bare feet, as he liked to say, at a time when the average height of men was 5 feet 6 inches. And his hands came down to his knees almost. Frederick Douglass, on the other hand, was blessed with a rich, deep baritone voice that was very musical. Douglass was musical himself. His wife, Anna Murray, part of the reason they fell in love is their shared love of music. He learned to play the fiddle from her. They sang hymns together. He had a beautiful, rich baritone voice. And Douglass was also, even his enemies acknowledged that he was handsome, majestic in his wrath, as one convert said. It didn't help that he was light-skinned black rather than full-blooded black because of racism. And Douglass, there are numerous examples of Douglass as an abolitionist orator converting most of the town. I'll give you one example. Douglass, when he's hired by William Lloyd Garrison's American Anti-Slavery Society in the 1840s, he goes on this 100 convention tour through the northern states, midwestern states, and one of the towns he seeks to abolitionize is Buffalo, New York. At that time, Buffalo was this raw, very fast-growing town. Douglass arrives with his speaking partner, John Collins, who's a white man. And when they arrive, in the first venue, there are only 5 people waiting to hear him speak. They're 5 cabbies. They're dirty. They have whips in their hands. And Collins, Douglass' speaking partner, is so distraught he doesn't even wait to give his speech. He just hops back on the ferry and goes back to Cleveland. And Douglass famously says he's left to do Buffalo by himself. That first speech is to 5 people. Within 10 days, there wasn't a venue in Buffalo large enough to contain the people who wanted to hear Douglass speak. So he spoke on the village green to what he estimated was half of the population of the city, converting the multitude, so to speak, either to the cause of anti-slavery or to abolitionism. And I'll describe that distinction later. Words matter. The power of language is hard to overestimate, particularly at that day when there was no competition with the kind of imagery that exists today. The second parallel and the reasons for their rise up that I'll just briefly summarize is that both men married up, and the women in their lives, in my view, were indispensable to their success. Douglass, who's born a slave, marries Anna Murray, who's a free white woman, or free black woman, sorry. Never been a slave. He met her. She worked as a domestic in Baltimore. And it's her money that she had saved that allows Frederick Douglass to buy a train ticket that takes him north to freedom in New York City. It's her money that allows him to acquire the equivalent of a passport that he can show the conductor to pass as a free sailor. And it's her money that allows him to dress as a free black sailor. And then when he is first hired by the American Anti-Slavery Society, she works as a domestic because his income isn't enough to support their young family. They have 2 kids at this point. She works as a domestic so that he can start on his career as a writer and a lecturer. Had it not been for Anna Murray, myself and most scholars suggest that there's no way Douglass could have become free when he did. And Mary Todd Lincoln is still often dismissed as a kind of madwoman in the attic. More a liability to Lincoln than an asset. And yet Mary Todd Lincoln was at least as savvy about politics as Lincoln was when they met. They met around the 1840 presidential campaign. They were both passionate Whigs. The founder of the Whig Party was Henry Clay. Mary Todd grew up right next door, essentially, the next plantation over from Henry Clay in Kentucky. She sat on Clay's knee when she was a little girl. She understood Clay's American system and the Whig Party at least as well as Lincoln did. And in fact, Stephen Douglas, Lincoln's great nemesis, wanted to date Mary Todd, and Mary Todd said, "No way am I going to date a Democrat." Politics is what brought them together, and she advised Lincoln in virtually every step of his rise from Illinois legislator to the White House. In fact, one example is after Lincoln serves one term in the U.S. House of Representatives, comes back home to Illinois, campaigns for Zachary Taylor, and he's offered the governorship of the Oregon Territory. And Mary Todd says, don't go there. You go there and you'll be forgotten. That'll be the end of your political ambitions. And essentially, she was right. Women and their lives are indispensable to their success. The third parallel is that, ironically, at the very moment in which Douglas and Lincoln are aspiring intellectuals, falling in love with language and the power of words, they both enter into a fight, fairly vicious fight, that they define as the turning point in their careers. For Douglas, if you've read Douglas's narrative or any of Douglas's autobiographical writings, is this fight with the slave breaker Edward Covey. He returns to the eastern shore of Maryland after he's learned his ABCs in Baltimore as the playmate of this white boy. He trades biscuits for words on the streets of Baltimore. He finds sheets of paper of the King James Bible discarded, and he picks it up and washes it off and memorizes those two pages. I mean, he does everything to become literate. He returns to Eastern Shore. He's now literate. And what happens with literacy? It gives you a sense of dignity and confidence. He stands up to his master, looks his master in the eye. His master, Thomas Auld, said, this is inappropriate for a slave. He hires out Douglas to Covey, who's known as a slave breaker, known throughout the Eastern Shore of Maryland as someone who can break the will of an insolent slave. And Covey brutalizes Douglas at least once a week for the first 6 months. Douglas says the welts in his back are as thick as his thumb. They haven't yet healed, and he gets another whipping. And after 6 months of this sadism, he decides to stand up to Covey and concludes, even if he dies in the attempt, he decides to stand up to Covey. They have a two-hour epic battle. Douglas, like Lincoln, is very big and tall. In fact, even more muscular than Lincoln in the shoulders and chest. He's over 6 feet. Covey's the average-sized guy, like 5'6". And Douglas does not go on the offensive, primarily parries blows. And after 2 hours, Covey gives up. And Douglas famously said that Covey was mastered by a boy of 16. And Douglas says, from that moment, he defined himself as a free man in form, even if he would remain a slave in fact. And in a sense, you could say that his life's mission began to be clarified in the wake of that fight, which was freedom not only for himself, but for everyone, and the beginnings of this vision of racial equality. And Lincoln enters into a fight when he's 21 years old. Lincoln did not get along with his father. Thomas Lincoln was virtually illiterate, was a very accomplished farmer and carpenter. His primary goal was survival in this backwoods of Illinois and Indiana, which is a brutal, vicious community. And Lincoln had to turn over every penny he earned to his father until he reached 21, until he reached the age of manhood. And once he reaches 21, he moves to New Salem. The local leader, one of the local leaders in New Salem, is a man named Jack Armstrong, who's essentially a thug. Armstrong was known for luring strangers into poker games, beating them up, and taking their money. Armstrong was also known, there's a terrific book on oral histories of Lincoln's upbringing in Indiana and Illinois. Armstrong was known for roasting a live pig. And Armstrong sees Lincoln enter the town, and he feels threatened by Lincoln because of his size, because of his passion for language, and challenges Lincoln to a no-holds-barred rough and tumble. It was a kind of fight where it's truly no holds barred. It was not uncommon for a man to lose part of a nose, part of an ear, part of a finger. And one of the great prizes in a no holds barred rough and tumble was to liberate an opponent's eyeball and keep it as a trophy. It wasn't a nice kind of fighting. Lincoln, like Douglas, didn't like fighting. He says, I'm not going to challenge you. I'm not going to accept a no-holds-barred rough and tumble. I'll accept a regulated wrestling match, which is more subdued. Unclear exactly what happened because of the haze of memory and hundreds of people gathered around to bet. Best we know is that Armstrong fouled Lincoln because there were certain regulations. Lincoln called the foul. No one lost money. They called the fight a draw, and Armstrong befriended Lincoln after that. And Lincoln started to perceive himself as a leader. In fact, 6 months after that, he's elected captain of his company during the Black Hawk War. And after that tenure's over, he soon begins his long tenure as an Illinois state legislature. So those are three of the parallels that I mentioned. Douglas and Lincoln knew of each other in the 1850s, but it's safe to say that on the eve of the Civil War, when Lincoln delivers his inaugural address, they were as close as they would ever be to being enemies. You could say, why is that? Because Lincoln hated slavery as much as anyone. As much as any abolitionist. He never defined himself as an abolitionist, but he said he hated slavery as much as an abolitionist. He was an anti-slavery advocate, by which he understood himself as advocating gradual abolition over a long period of time. In fact, in his debates with Stephen Douglas, when pressed on when he envisioned the ultimate extinction of slavery to occur, Lincoln said, not less than 100 years. That would have put the end of slavery in 1958 at the earliest. Now, Frederick Douglass is a radical abolitionist, by which he meant that he advocated an end to slavery as quickly as possible and racial equality. From Douglass's perspective, this gradual abolition vision was not being really that sympathetic to the plight of slaves. Lincoln was a politician. Lincoln, especially in Illinois, had he championed immediate abolition, and had he called himself an abolitionist, it would have been political suicide. Lincoln was first and foremost a very savvy, brilliant politician. The next aspect, the next prong of this three-pronged solution to slavery for Lincoln is that he advocated compensation to masters with gradual abolition for the loss of their property. From Douglass' perspective, this again wasn't being exactly sympathetic to the plight of the slaves. And the third prong is what especially outraged Douglass. Lincoln, like most other white opponents of slavery in the North, champion colonization, meaning as we gradually free blacks, we encourage them, voluntary, we encourage them to leave the United States, go back to Africa, go to whether it's Liberia, which is already a colony, or someplace in the South America, which essentially highlights the degree to which Lincoln, like most other anti-slavery white Northerners, in 1859, 1860, had a hard time conceptualizing American democracy as anything other than a white man's democracy. They didn't want women voting. They didn't want blacks voting. Even though Lincoln did say that black man and a black woman had as much right to receive the fruits of his or her own labor as a white man or a white woman. There's a difference between enjoying the fruits of your labor and being equal as voters and as citizens. And what almost sent Douglass over the edge, in fact, Douglass comes closest to abandoning his ideal of the Declaration of Independence immediately following reading Lincoln's first inaugural address in 1861. What does Lincoln say in his inaugural address that leads Douglass to plan a trip to Haiti with the intention of immigrating and encouraging other blacks to immigrate because he's lost faith in the United States ever achieving its ideal of freedom and equality. Well, to be fair to Lincoln, it's important to contextualize Lincoln's first inaugural address. He gives his first inaugural at a time in which seven states have already seceded, the Confederacy's already been formed. He's not delivering his inaugural address to Douglas or blacks or abolitionists. His intention is to speak to the Southerners, especially states who have seceded, with the hope of encouraging them to return to the Union and to prevent the Upper South, like Virginia, from following the Lower South and seceding. So Lincoln says two things in particular that outrage Frederick Douglass. One is, he says he will add teeth to, he will be more vigorous in enforcing the fugitive slave law, which Douglass and other black and white abolitionists considered a law that virtually legitimated the kidnapping of free blacks. More onerously, Lincoln, right before he gives his inaugural address, learned that Congress, as part of this large attempt to conciliate with Southerners and avoid a war, Congress had passed a new constitutional amendment. It was the first 13th Amendment, and Congress passed it a day before Lincoln delivers his inaugural address. And this first 13th Amendment is an unamendable amendment, that's technically the language, that guarantees slavery in the slave states forever. And Lincoln in his inaugural address says, I have no objection to it, even though I haven't read it. And Douglass, when he reads this, says, if this president endorses the Congress in agreeing to this new constitutional amendment that guarantees slavery in the slave states forever, how can this nation ever achieve its ideals? Plans to go to Haiti. He doesn't go because South bombs Fort Sumner for 48 hours. And when that happened, Douglass stays because he recognizes, before Lincoln, honestly, he recognizes that civil war is a golden opportunity to end slavery. Douglass says from the beginning of the war itself, he's a newspaper editor, he sends all of his issues to Lincoln, he sends his speeches that are often published to Lincoln in the White House. And his main point is that the easiest way to win the war is to free the slaves, arm them, put them to work for the Union. Slaves constitute a third of the Southern population, a third of the Confederate population. They're a potent source of black power that the Union can tap into. And Lincoln is concerned about constitutional issues, which is why he doesn't do it immediately. Congress is actually ahead of Lincoln in passing the first Confiscation Act in August of 1861, which authorizes Union officers to confiscate slaves who've reached Union lines. But by 1862, as you know, and culminating with the Emancipation Proclamation, Lincoln is completely on board Douglass's vision. And so Douglass goes through this evolution of considering Lincoln, the beginning from Lincoln's inaugural address to being more a liability than an asset to his cause, to considering Lincoln to be the greatest president following the Emancipation Proclamation. Douglass considers that proclamation to be, after the Declaration of Independence, the greatest document in American history. And even though the Emancipation Proclamation, which frees only slaves of rebel masters, not slaves of loyal masters, meaning border states like Kentucky, Douglass rightly says, with slavery ended in Mississippi, there's no way it can endure in Kentucky or Missouri. And the Emancipation Proclamation also calls for the arming of blacks as soldiers in the North. And that's especially symbolic because the question of citizenship was open-ended at the time. It's before the 14th Amendment. There's a huge debate on what constitutes citizenship. The one theme in which no one disputed whether or not you were a citizen is if you served in the United States military. If you were a soldier, served for the Navy, there's no dispute. You are a United States citizen. And now Lincoln is authorizing the arming of blacks as soldiers, by which he and everyone else also understands that it means blacks are now citizens. Blacks are now political equals under the law. And that leads to the first meeting. Douglas begins recruiting. He quits editing his newspaper. He devotes full time to recruiting for blacks in the northern states. Douglas almost single-handedly recruits for the famous 54th Massachusetts Colored Regiment. His two sons are among the first two recruits. And then he's frustrated by mid-1863 because black soldiers are paid half of what white soldiers are. They're not being promoted for valiant service. And Douglas finally says, I'm going to go to Washington, D.C. and see if I can have a meeting with the president and knock some sense into him. So on August 10th, 1863, Douglas goes to Washington, D.C. on his own accord. He arrives early in the morning. He goes to the White House. I'm simplifying the story. There's already a long line of blacks waiting, or a long line of whites waiting to see President Lincoln. He thinks he's going to have to wait all day, maybe more. He sends up his card, and within 2 minutes, he's called up to the office. And as he passes all the whites in line and climbs the steps to Lincoln's office, he hears one white man mumble, I see how it is, they let the nigger through. And when Lincoln meets Douglas, he says, hello, Mr. Douglas, I know you. It's wonderful to finally meet you. I know you've been very critical of me, especially my tardiness. And he first defends himself before he asks Douglas what he wants. They have an hour-long meeting. Lincoln explains why he has been slow at paying black soldiers what white soldiers are being paid. He said, you have to understand my position. I've got the border states and all these whites who are not happy about me putting guns in the arms of black men and telling them to kill and shoot white men, given the racism in the United States. And Lincoln also promised to eventually promote blacks for valiant service. After this meeting, they publicly announced themselves as friends of the other at a time in which friendship had the profound symbolic connotation. The next man that Lincoln met at the White House, he told, and we know it because of his account, Lincoln said, I just had a meeting with Frederick Douglass, and I consider him the most meritorious man in these United States. There's virtually no higher praise than that at that time. And Douglas gave a speech the next day after this meeting and said, I had a meeting with President Lincoln. I consider him the king of self-made men. And this, again, virtually no higher praise than that. The very term self-made man was coined when Douglas and Lincoln were young boys. The idea of rising up from the dregs, that was still considered a fairly new concept. The second meeting really highlights, far more than the first, the degree to which Lincoln needed Douglas. It's August of 1864. If you know anything about Civil War history, you realize that Lincoln and virtually everyone else in Washington are certain that Lincoln is going to lose re-election. Because the war's been going bad, the casualties is far worse than anybody had imagined, and it's almost certain that Democrats are going to win the election. And if Democrats win, their platform is a peace platform. Negotiated settlement, let's end the war. If that happens, slavery almost certainly will remain intact. So Lincoln says, he sends a telegram to Douglass's home in Rochester, says, please come to the White House, I need you, I need your help. So this trip is an all-expense-paid trip. Presidential carriage is waiting to pick Douglas up from the train station. He arrives at the White House. Lincoln says, I need your help. As you probably know, I think I'm going to lose re-election. If I do, if the Democrat who becomes George McClellan is elected, slavery will almost certainly or probably remain intact. What I'd like you to do is to embark upon a John Brown scheme. Now, Douglas had been a close friend of John Brown, who raids Harper's Ferry. It's one of the major sparks leading to Civil War. And Lincoln says, I want you to take some hand-picked men that are disseminated throughout the South that will bring as many blacks into Union lines as possible. Best case scenario, these blacks brought to Union lines will raise scores of regiments, allow us to achieve a major military victory that will turn the tide of public opinion in the North that will help me get reelected. And in that case, Lincoln's main platform is now the 13th Amendment that abolishes slavery everywhere. And Lincoln says, worst case scenario is I lose, but at least tens of thousands, maybe more blacks will be brought to Union lines and thus to freedom. And Douglas says, I never recognized the degree to which President Lincoln hated slavery until that moment. Lincoln, or Douglas, embarks upon this John Brown scheme. Essentially, it's a precursor to the special forces. Seriously, he writes a 20-page essay. It's like the precursor to Green Berets or Navy SEALs. 20-page essay outlining the organization. Lincoln loves it, but then Sherman takes Atlanta, dramatically changes the tide of public opinion, and these special forces aren't needed. The third meeting occurs at Lincoln's second inaugural. Douglas is invited, has virtually a front row seat, and Lincoln sees him in the crowd. Douglas is invited to the reception afterward. When he enters the White House, Lincoln is in the elegant East Room, surrounded by a crowd of whites, and he sees Douglas enter. And he raises his long arm. He says, here comes my friend Frederick Douglass. I saw you in the crowd today. What did you think of my inaugural address? There is no man in these United States whose opinion I value more than yours. And Douglas responded, Mr. Lincoln, that was a sacred effort. Lincoln had invited Douglas to have tea or dinner at the soldier's home on several other occasions. Douglas couldn't do it because he already had speaking engagements. Lincoln, of course, is assassinated a month later. Had he lived, their friendship would certainly have continued and, in my view, grown richer. So what do we learn about Douglas and the friendship of Douglas and Lincoln? Let me just sketch out three themes, and then I'll point out what they were up against. First is, I think it's crucial to understand that Douglas and Lincoln's friendship was utilitarian. By that I mean that Douglas recognized that he needed President Lincoln on his side to help him achieve his chief aim, which was freedom and equality, racial equality. And what's significant is that Lincoln, as president, understood that he needed Douglas on his side, the widely understood representative, the most significant, important African-American, the kind of ambassador to blacks. Lincoln needed him on his side in order for him to achieve his chief aim of preserving the Union. Because after all, as president taking the oath of office, that's what he swears to do. Preserve the Union. And so these discrete aims had converged into one. In order to preserve the Union, you had to end slavery and move toward racial equality. In order to end slavery and to begin to envision interracial democracy, you also had to preserve the Union. These discrete goals had converged. And that's crucial. It also highlights the degree to which Douglas and Lincoln, they genuinely liked each other. They felt comfortable around each other. They said this in their correspondence. They genuinely enjoyed each other's company, and yet they never agreed politically. Douglas is always, I call him a prudent revolutionary. Lincoln is a moderate Republican. Lincoln never defines himself as a radical. Lincoln is horrified of the idea of revolution, and yet they genuinely enjoy each other. And in this day and age, the idea that two people who do not see eye to eye politically can still enjoy each other's company and work together is an unusual thing. And it's a crucial symbol of democracy. Democracy isn't about everyone agreeing on the same thing and just ramrodding it through. Democracy is about many different people from all different points of view agreeing to respect, befriend, work together with an overarching goal. The second second lesson, which is a very simple one, is that Douglas and Lincoln both faced a common enemy, the Confederacy, conceived as a way to perpetuate and expand slavery, that threatened both Douglas and his vision and his mission and Lincoln himself. It's related to the utilitarian theme. And the third, which I think is important, is that their friendship related to Douglas and Lincoln's own conception of the very notion of self-making. Now, self-made men or self-made women for most people today simply means rising up to get rich. At that time, when the term was coined, that's not what it meant. Self-made man and Douglas, who was one of the foremost pro-feminist men of his day, self-made women also. What it meant is that the true self-made man or woman, as you evolve and as you rise up, you seek to reform your society. As Douglas said in a speech that became one of his most famous speeches, Self-Made Man, he said, the true self-made man or woman seeks to eradicate the sins of his or her society. As you evolve, you also reform your society. Lincoln believed the same thing. And that's very different than what a lot of Southerners believed. Their understanding of self-making was also the notion of a self that's in a continual state of evolution or flux. The self, it should never be fixed. It continually evolves. And indeed, who Frederick Douglass and who Abraham Lincoln were in 1830 was very different than who they were in 1840 and 1850, and both of them changed most dramatically during the Civil War years. And that idea of a self continually evolving or being in flux explodes the very conceptions of both slavery and racism. Because slavery constitutes an understanding of society in which there is a very heavy ceiling that's very low, above which you cannot rise. Slavery meant you are a slave for life. And racism, among other things, is defined by the understanding that one group of people are permanently superior to another group of people. Again, it reflects this fixity. The Douglas and Lincoln's understanding of self-making explodes. In many respects, Lincoln's counterpart as a self-made man, the kind of bad version of self-made man, was Nathan Bedford Forrest. Nathan Bedford Forrest, like Lincoln, grew up in a border state in a log cabin. Nathan Bedford Forrest, by the eve of the Civil War, becomes a multimillionaire. How? Because he becomes one of the South's most significant slave traders. During the Civil War, he's a Confederate cavalry general, and after the war, he helps found the Ku Klux Klan. That's a very different trajectory of self-making. A very different trajectory of self-making. Let me just show you a couple images that highlight what Douglas and Lincoln are up against, and then I'll field some questions. So this is a slide by two scientists from 1850. Four, Josiah Nott and George Glidden, among the preeminent scientists. They are technically called ethnologists. It's a precursor of anthropologists. And it's the slide that encapsulates the thesis of their book, which is a rare work of science, which was a best-selling work of science. And essentially, their thesis is to emphasize the degree to which blacks are subhuman. You have on the top a statue of Apollo Belvedere as the kind of representative white. And next to Apollo Belvedere, you have a skull. Now, how you get a skull out of a statue, I'm not sure, but they do. And then you have in the middle image, what's called a Negro and the skull of a Negro in the bottom is a young chimpanzee and the skull of a young chimpanzee. The reason why the skulls are important is because there was an understanding that the line from the forehead to the jawbone, if it were vertical, that somehow meant that you had greater cranium capacity, you had larger brains. And if it was a slanted line from the forehead to the jaw, it meant you had a reduced brain capacity or cranium. And you can see in this image, it's not difficult to conclude that blacks have a cranium or brain capacity that's more akin to apes than to humans. That was their basic message. Blacks are subhuman, more akin to apes than they are to human. The very term highbrow, lowbrow still evolves from this very racist premise. Charles Diaz's Devil and Tom Walker, it's from a short story by Washington Irving. The reason I'm showing you this is that this is a painting. There are numerous prints that were widely circulated. The devil here is cast as a black man. In the writings or the visions of 90% of white Americans, the devil is a black man. This is the Fruits of Amalgamation by Edward Clay, actually a nephew of Henry Clay. And it encapsulates the vision, the horror of, for most northern whites, of what will happen if you emancipate blacks, if you emancipate slaves. And the fruits of the emancipation, instead of racial equality, if blacks are freed, essentially it inverts what racist whites assume to be the natural order of things, white supremacy, and it becomes black supremacy. Here, the former white patriarch of the household is now a servant in the background. The black patriarch has married a white woman. It's playing on racist fears that if you free black men, they're just going to want to have sex with white women. And they have two grotesque-looking children, also highlighting the unnaturalness of interracial marriage or interracial sex. You have another white servant in the foreground. You have a dog chewing up Tom Paine's Age of Reason. You have William Lloyd Garrison's portrait on this wall, and Othello and Desdemona, this play, Shakespeare's play of interracial love and union, in the hot foreground, on the other wall. So it's this horror vision of what will happen if you free blacks. This is a broadside, a cartoon, political cartoon from 1864, from the time of the Lincoln's second inaugural, or the 1864 election. That's called miscegenation. The very term miscegenation, about the fear of especially interracial sex between black men and white women, that term is coined by Democrats as part of the 1864 presidential election. I mean, it was the greatest race-baiting election in American history. And you have in the center Frederick Douglass in a carriage, who's at the center, and on the left foreground, you have Lincoln bowing and being introduced to the radical abolitionist Senator Charles Sumner's black mistress. Again, this fear, this horror of what will happen to the United States if we allow the Lincoln administration to have its way. Richard Caton Woodville is a well-known painter. There were literally hundreds of thousands of prints of this. It was from called War News from Mexico of 1848, a war that enabled Southerners to acquire millions more acres of land that they hoped would be for slavery. It was a war like Vietnam, especially in New England. New Englanders were vehemently opposed to the Mexican War. And the reason I'm showing this slide is because this scene takes place inside the American Hotel. American is cut off. And inside the portico of the American Hotel, you have this very wide range of whites. Old, young, wealthy, modest, plebeian, and some who look relatively poor. But because only the whites are inside the portico of the American Hotel, it symbolizes the vision of American democracy at this time, which is essentially for white men. And you have two blacks, a father and a daughter, sitting outside the American Hotel, outside the American body politic. Woodville represents them and comparatively sympathetically, but they're not part of the larger body politic, which highlights, again, mainstream white views. Here's the relatively sympathetic portrait of them. And Southerners engaged in their own pictorial warfare, and their vision, slavery was a positive good. They argued the slaves were part of their big happy family. They treated slaves just like their children. They didn't want to advertise the fact that they also liked to go into the slave quarters, the men did, and have sex with slaves and increase the value of their property. But they argued that slavery was a natural, benevolent institution. And this is Josiah Wedgwood's Am I Not a Man and a Brother becomes the motto of the American Anti-Slavery Society, of a slave in chains kneeling down, praying, supplicating to God, am I not a man and a brother? But for some white paternals, there's also an understanding that they're not only praying to God, but praying to whites, that whites should be in charge of helping slaves become free. This is an 1848 version. Now the slave has hamstring muscles to die for and biceps and triceps to die for. He can easily rise up himself. There's an evolution of the understanding of a slave able to break his chains himself. And Douglas, as a way to avoid any confusion about who this slave is supplicating to, he includes this in the frontispiece of one of his books. He actually includes Christ there. It's unambiguous that the slave is appealing to Christ, not to white men. And this is two images of the Freedmen's Monument. It coincides in 1876 with Douglass's, in my view, his greatest single speech on Abraham Lincoln. It's the unveiling of the monument on the anniversary of Lincoln's assassination. This one is in Boston. This one's in Lincoln Park in Washington, D.C. And Douglass was the keynote speaker for an audience that included President Grant, who unveiled the monument, all of Congress, all of the Supreme Court, virtually all the heads of states were there. And Douglass gives this talk on Lincoln, and he begins his speech by saying, you, and he's saying you meaning whites, you are Lincoln's children. We, meaning me and blacks, are Lincoln's stepchildren, which I can imagine gasps coming from the crowd. Why? He says, because Lincoln, as president, his chief aim was to preserve the Union. And we were stepchildren because ending slavery, including us as part of the national family, was an afterthought. He said, judged on abolition grounds, Lincoln is dull, tardy, backward. But that's not how he should be judged. He was first and foremost a politician. As president, he took an oath of office to preserve the nation. His greatness, his brilliance, was in adopting us under the rubric of his mission as president, as politician, adopting us into the national family. And for that, he receives our greatest merit. For the rest of his life, Douglass's greatest hero was Abraham Lincoln, followed by John Brown. Here's Douglass's 1852. I mean, it's a great photograph. It's a daguerreotype that highlights the degree to which Douglass was considered majestic in his wrath, considered handsome. He always dressed up in every public performance that he gave because he wanted to send a message through his words, through his poise, through his dress, that he deserved entry into the wealthiest parlors of the White House as much as any white. In essence, Douglass's mission was to out-citizen white citizens, to convince whites that through his speaking, through his rhetoric, through his writing, through his presence and his persona, he deserved citizenship as much as any white did. Here's Lincoln, the famous Matthew Brady photograph that, according to a number of accounts, helped elect Lincoln because it was the first time Lincoln appears presidential. It's the first time Lincoln is photographed with a suit on that actually fits him. And it was widely circulated. And in 1860, he wasn't that well known. And because of the wide circulation, people came to recognize Lincoln through this photograph of Matthew Brady. In fact, Matthew Brady, after the war, said, I elected Abraham Lincoln. Here's the second inaugural that I described. Here's Douglas. I drew a red circle around it. There's Douglas. There's Lincoln giving the inaugural address. You can see, literally has a front row seat. And John Wilkes Booth is right there. There's Douglas in 76. He's holding the cane that had been Lincoln's favorite cane. Mary Todd gives Douglas Lincoln's cane as a tribute after his assassination. Here's Mary Todd, dresses made by the former slave, now dressmaker Elizabeth Keckley. There's Anna Murray, who I described Douglas's first wife. She dies in 1882, and Douglas marries a white woman. It wasn't a politically correct marriage. Her name was Helen Pitt. She was an Irish woman. She was 20 years younger than Douglas and Douglas's secretary. Douglas did not handle this second marriage well. He publicly said, well, my first wife was the hue of my mother. The second wife is the hue of my father. His children were outraged. Whites were outraged. In my view, what Douglas should have said is, I've devoted my career to this vision of interracial democracy. What better symbol of interracial democracy than a marriage to someone who's not of my skin color? There's Douglas as an older man. Douglas met with every subsequent president after Lincoln, didn't advise them all until his death in 1895. And one indication of Douglas's fame, he's on the front page of Harper's Weekly more than once. This is in 1876. 1883. He was also on the cover in 1876. Harper's Weekly at that time, you could think of it as Time magazine or Life magazine in the mid-20th century, where everyone read it. And this is the lion-like Douglas a year before his death, grabbing the arm of a carved chair with a lion on it. And this is Douglas following his death, a deathbed image. He was taken a few hours after Douglas died. The book that that Norton is publishing in 6 months is a book on Douglas and photography. I discovered that Douglas, there are more photographs, more separate photographs of Frederick Douglass than of any other 19th century American. More than Lincoln, more than Whitman, more than Grant, more than any peer. Douglas was in love with photography and believed it was a crucial aid in his reform work. And that's it. Douglas and Lincoln have been huge inspirations for individuals throughout the 20th century, not only politicians and leaders, but rank and file Americans, not just black for Douglas, but whites. People who've read him have truly been immensely influenced by the power of their words. Douglas and Lincoln hopefully will continue to inspire us as Americans to bind up the nation's wounds, to complete, finally, the unfinished work of the nation, and to fulfill the ideals of freedom and equality of opportunity for all Americans. Thank you. Questions, comments, criticisms?
Great question.
So what's Douglass's relationship to other white leaders? Douglass's closest white friend, meaning the person he met with and corresponded with more than any other, from 1859 through the Civil War was Charles Sumner, the Massachusetts radical anti-slavery leader, who was actually himself a very close friend with Lincoln. In fact, Sumner met with Lincoln virtually every day in the White House. They had a very close relationship. And so Sumner was well aware of Douglass's meetings with Lincoln. Douglass also had, he met Emerson twice, didn't get to know Emerson that well. And Emerson was someone who, living in Concord, Massachusetts, did not interact that much with blacks. I mean, Concord then and now is pretty lily white. And one of the characteristics among whites, in order for them to feel comfortable among blacks and to treat blacks fully as equals, is the more time you spend living or working or eating and just and socializing with blacks as equals, as social equals, the more able you are to shed the power of racism that I sketched out. And Lincoln in Springfield, Illinois, actually interacted not with blacks as equals. Billy the Barber, he had a barbershop that Lincoln went to a lot. Lincoln genuinely felt comfortable around African Americans, spent far more time with blacks than someone like Emerson or Thoreau did. And in fact, not just Douglass, but every African-American who met with Lincoln in the White House, and far more blacks met with Lincoln in the White House than all subsequent presidents combined. And one of the things they said is that Lincoln treated them as men and women, not as black men or black women. And Douglass said the same thing. So the number of meetings, you know, was only three between Douglass and Lincoln, but Lincoln's background is having interacted on a regular basis with African Americans was far more than, you know, many people like Emerson, who defined himself as a radical abolitionist, was legally an accessory after the fact of John Brown's raid. In fact, hosts John Brown, when Brown visits Concord twice, invites Brown to spend the night at his house. In fact, Thoreau and Emerson had a fight over whose home John Brown would spend the night with. So that's a crucial theme of this interracial alliance that I'm sketching out. And Charles Sumner felt comfortable because Sumner grew up in the black neighborhood of Boston. The black neighborhood of Boston is Beacon Hill. His two friends, lifelong friends, grew up, and I've done the walk. It's a 30-second walk from the boarding house where Sumner lived. When Sumner dies, he wanted to be buried in the 50% black cemetery in the west end of Beacon Hill. His friends and supporters, against his wishes, had him buried in Mount Auburn Cemetery. And it's no coincidence that Sumner issues the Civil Rights Bill that literally becomes the blueprint for Johnson's 1964 Civil Rights Act. It was passed in a watered-down version in 1875, a year after Sumner died, to honor him, and then Supreme Court overturned it 8 years later, saying it violated states' rights, which highlights the kind of counter-revolution that the Southerners wage to turn back the equality before the law. Question: what do I feel about this treatment of Johnson in the movie Selma? So Nick Kotz, if any of you are interested in a wonderful book that focuses on Johnson and Martin Luther King Jr.'s relationship. It's Nick Kotz's dual biography of Johnson and King Jr. And the Selma film hews fairly closely to Nick Kotz's book. I mean, the film downplays Johnson's passion for wanting to achieve a voting rights bill. It downplays Johnson's passion for seeking to fulfill finally the ideals of the revolution, really. And but Johnson and Martin Luther King Jr. had a fraught relationship. So, for example, King and Johnson never once defined themselves as friends. Johnson to whites. Johnson is a white Southerner at a time in which racism arguably was worse when Johnson is a young boy than it was in Douglass's day. And there are numerous instances in Kotz's transcripts that he looked at in which Johnson refers to King using the N-word, just dropping the N-word like a, just like it falls off his shoulder. Lincoln never once refers to Douglass or any specific other African American using the N-word or using that kind of language. So I think it's significant that that Lincoln and Douglass had a far richer relationship than King and Johnson. Part of the reason, I would argue, is similar to what I've just said, is that the more a white man or woman spends time living with, interacting with, working with, being around African Americans, the more they recognize, hey, they're just like us. They're humans just like us. And Lincoln grew up spending a lot more time around African Americans than Johnson did. Part of it is because, Johnson as a young boy, he grew up in the Jim Crow South. So I think that helps to understand someone like Johnson. Question. So what did Douglass and Lincoln think about Harriet Beecher Stowe? So Lincoln met with Stowe at the White House in 1862, and allegedly, when he met with Stowe, said, so you're the lady who wrote the book that started this great war. Now, that comes from Stowe's son, who wrote her biography 40 years later. So there's good evidence that Lincoln did not say that, but if he didn't, in my view, he should have. Because no book of any kind galvanized or electrified Northerners in their vigorous opposition to slavery than Uncle Tom's Cabin. Because it comes in the wake of the Fugitive Slave Law, and why that book is so significant and so important is because Uncle Tom's Cabin, for the first time, convinces Northerners that they can no longer wash their hands from slavery. You could say before Uncle Tom's Cabin and before the Fugitive Slave Law, most Northerners hated slavery, opposed slavery, but they'd say, hey, what? It's not my problem. It's the South's problem. I got more immediate things to worry about. After Fugitive Slave Law and after Uncle Tom's Cabin, then it highlights what the Fugitive Slave Law is about, which is that it turns northern soil into hunting grounds for the pleasure of slave catchers. And it means that it nationalizes slavery. It means that it allows federal troops to come to Boston to ensure that a suspected fugitive is sent back to slavery. And it also requires, by law, any white man or woman in the community, actually any white man in the community, to be deputized, forced to round up a suspected fugitive at a moment's notice. So let's say I'm living in a place like Manchester, Vermont, and there aren't that many blacks in Manchester in 1850, but there are some, and let's say one of them is a fugitive who's now a well-known blacksmith or shoemaker or restaurateur, and suddenly a slave catcher comes and catches him, and they weren't rigorous about identifying who they were and said, you're a slave, I'm going to send you back. And I'm his neighbor, I'd be deputized to help round him up. And if I refused, it's a huge fine, $1,000, which is $75,000 in today's money. And if I was caught aiding and abetting this neighbor, it'd be a minimum jail term. So essentially, Stowe's book captured or highlighted the degree to which Northerners can no longer act like Pontius Pilate and wash their hands from slavery. And nothing does more than increase the free soil, the members of the Free Soil Party, the Republican Party. It's the between the Fugitive Slave Law and Uncle Tom's Cabin. It makes Emerson, Thoreau, all of the Boston Transcendentalists suddenly take a serious interest in slavery and calling themselves abolitionists. 1849, they weren't doing. 1844, 1848, Emerson basically said, you know, he criticized the abolition movement. Now in 1852, 1853, he's a huge fan. So Stowe's book was absolutely crucial. And Douglas called Stowe's book the masterwork of literature in the 19th century. He said, no book captures the significance and offers a rationale for higher law than Uncle Tom's Cabin. How many of you have read Uncle Tom's Cabin? Good, that's very impressive. So there's a scene in there, wonderful scene. It's also a feminist book between Mr. and Mrs. Bird. Mrs. Bird is this very petite white woman. Senator Bird is her husband, who's just voted for the Fugitive Slave Law, and he comes home, and Mrs. Bird says, how could you do such a thing? I read my Bible, and my Bible tells me, you know, the do unto others as you would be done by. How could you do such a thing? And her husband says, well, you just don't understand politics. She's like, well, I understand my Bible. And then Eliza, the fugitive, reaches their home. Senator Bird ends up harboring, aiding, and abetting this fugitive, changes his ways. So it's a brilliant scene that captures the significance of higher law and also pointing out that the federal government should follow the morals of the women in the home. The foundation of American jurisprudence should be based on the morality within the domestic sphere that's disseminated by women. And Douglas endorses that whole hog. What was Douglas's reaction to Lincoln's assassination? He was horrified, as everyone else was in the North, absolutely horrified. He was at his desk in Rochester, New York, and he heard about it, and there was an impromptu meeting. I mean, the Northerners were just overwrought with just profound suffering. Lincoln was shot on Good Friday, died on Holy Saturday, and that Saturday evening there's an impromptu meeting at Corinthian Hall and the large hall in Rochester, New York, and Douglas gives an impromptu speech, and in it he says, he first mourns Lincoln's death, and then is looking for meeting. If you read the speech, you can actually see him extemporizing, kind of working through it, and says that he hopes that Lincoln's death, as we mourn him, might be a source of regeneration for the nation. It might be another means by which white Northerners or true loyal fans of the Union, white Northerners and black Northerners, can unite as a group and to fulfill what Lincoln at his last day seeks. Lincoln is beginning to imagine citizenship for blacks as well as whites. In fact, it's what led John Wilkes Booth to assassinate him. Lincoln's last speech, there's a huge debate about how many freedmen and women, how many blacks should be included in suffrage. And Lincoln says, I mean, Lincoln is among the very first to say that the only way that we can win this war, the only way that we won the war, is with the aid of blacks. Without black soldiers, without black labor, there's no way we would have won the war. We need to treat them as full citizens. And John Wilkes Booth heard this address. He's at the White House. He's scheming Initially, his goal was to kidnap Lincoln, use Lincoln as ransom to force the Union to let free hundreds of thousands of soldiers. And then after Lee surrenders, Booth, and after hearing this speech, in fact, Booth says, there's a record of it, Booth says that that is the last speech Lincoln will make. He vows to assassinate him, which he does, and he received funding from the Confederacy, and that's what led to it. And so Douglas, you see him working through, how do we make sense of this horrific incident? It's the first time Douglas casts Lincoln in Christ-like terms. Much as Christ died for the sins of humankind, Lincoln dies for the sins of the country. We need to act on that and fulfill this symbolic mission. So was Douglas, as Reconstruction, as Southerners gain control of Reconstruction at the end, was Douglas champion extra-legal violence? No, he doesn't. Douglas was willing to champion extra-legal violence in the 1850s. He is a very close friend of John Brown. Brown asked him to be his right-hand man on his raid to Harper's Ferry, and Douglas says no because he thinks Brown is going to die, and he's right there. But he actually writes a newspaper editorial saying, I do not oppose conspiring against the U.S. government because this is a slave republic now. I don't oppose conspiring if I think it will succeed. After the war, and Douglas really latched on to, and I think it's been forgotten by a lot of Americans today, is the significance of the 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments. 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments that free all slaves, that guarantee citizenship, equal protection for all people to every person born in the United States, and guarantee full suffrage to all men. And there was, among the abolitionists and Douglas early, a debate wanting to include women. But the United States is virtually the only slave society in the New World in which freedmen and women achieve those legislative successes. No other emancipated society offers that kind of full citizenship. And without those Reconstruction amendments, there's no way that the modern civil rights movement ever would have gotten off the ground. Akhil Lamar, the Yale legal scholar, has really emphasized that point in a book. And Douglas recognizes the significance of those Reconstruction amendments. And the reason I mention that is because after Reconstruction, Douglas realizes that he doesn't need to rely on extra-legal violence. The Constitution, as it's now been amended, fulfills the ideals of the Declaration. The equal protection is written into the Constitution. Suffrage is written into the Constitution, and Douglas, after the 15th Amendment passes, continues fighting for female suffrage. And the abolition of slavery has been codified in the United States Constitution. So he takes the higher ground and refuses to accept extra-legal violence because he rightly recognizes he doesn't have to. Now the Constitution is fully on his side. Now the Constitution is fully in alignment, interpreted one way, with the Declaration. Were any Irish slaves brought to the United States after? So the Irish were sent to the Caribbean after Britain emancipated its slavery in the West Indies in 1834, and very, very few, in a statistically insignificant number. The blacks who were brought to do labor in the West Indies did not stay that long. They eventually brought in Indians and other foreigners to do the work. It wasn't a pretty sight. But no, they did not spend that much time in Did Douglas ever do something really wrong in his whole life? Yeah, I mean, I already said he handled his second marriage really badly. He handled his second marriage really bad. He handled his second marriage both to his family and to his and to the public horribly. It's a great question in my book, and I didn't really focus on it tonight, is that Douglas's flaw really was in his relationship with his family. Douglas was such a public persona. He grew apart from Anna Murray, his first wife. Now, part of that is because Anna Murray was barely literate, and Douglas's whole identity is based on his love of language. And as he's growing and developing and becoming this ever greater and more popular and significant intellectual and an editor, best-selling author, she remains virtually illiterate. They grow profoundly apart. She essentially becomes his servant. You know, he's on the road all the time. This was an age before easy transportation. I calculate that Douglas's two younger sons, he has four children, his two younger sons reach the age of like, the youngest reaches the age of five, and I figured out, I just did the numbers of how often he's on the road. They don't even know who his father is. You know, he comes home from a long trip, and it's like, oh, here's daddy. Who? He was not a great family man. In fact, of all of the 160 photographs of Frederick Douglass, there's not a single one of Douglass with any of his children, not a single one of Douglass with his wife. And photography meant a lot to Frederick Douglass. That's significant. That's symbolic. Douglass probably would have been better off not marrying in certain respects. I mean, he had a very fraught relationship with Anna Murray. I mean, there are letters in which he comes home and, you know, he expects to be the head of the house, and he just gets henpecked by his wife, who he considers a termagant, and it's not pretty. And because he feels guilty, and it's also in the letters, he overly indulges his children, gives them pretty much anything they want. So they don't grow up with the kind of work ethic that he has. And he becomes the recorder of deeds and the marshal of the District of Columbia, becomes a kind of elder statesman for the Republican Party, and gives his sons plum jobs because he can, so ensures that they're receive a decent salary. And again, never instills the kind of work ethic that Douglas just cut his eye teeth on. I mean, Douglas he worked all the time. I mean, and Douglas said, you know, he escapes from slavery at 20 years old. And he says, you know, in point of mental development, I'm zero. He literally tries to make up for lost time over the next 30, 40 years, saying, I'm way behind. So he works harder than everyone else, and something gives. And what gives is his family. Thank you very much.